Hello, and welcome to the programme. You know, there's a fair amount of effort involved with gardening. That's marvellous. That's why it's so healthy. But it's also...
Here's a plant that's found in most of Australia. No, sorry.
All right, nobody's perfect, but get this month's Gardening Australia magazine and you're on the way. Available from ABC shops, ABC centres, and look, just about everywhere.
Out now.
This week, the team are back in action and we've some beauties for you. You'll see vegetables, herbs and flowers grown indoors hydroponically. Do you wheeze, sneeze or itch when you're in the garden? Which plants cause allergic reactions? And you'll see some easily made garden tools designed for people with disabilities or anyone. Hello, welcome to the programme, and we're all raring to go. And we're going to start off by looking very closely at one of the most fascinating of all plants, the elkhorn ferns. But how do you grow them, or divide them, or even mount them? Look, it's dead easy when you know how.
The elkhorns are superb garden plants. They're specialised ferns called epiphytes. This means that they live on trees, and live on is important. They don't take anything away from the tree, they only use it for support. But put them on a tree in your garden in a place where they will get some shade from the direct summer sun. Give them regular watering, not daily, that might cause them to rot, and they will thrive. So much so that this particular fern, which was put on this tree a mere 6 years ago, is now big enough to divide. Now what you need for this job is to put your heart in your mouth and a good sharp knife in your hand. It's a little bit crude, but don't worry, it won't hurt the plant too much. We've got one nice little segment here. Well, that's the elkhorn fern, and now you can see how unusual and different it is. Let's just take this small area at the bottom here. It has two distinct types of fronds or leaves. The clasping one, this one here, over the back, is sterile, and what that does is grip the plant onto whatever you choose to put it on. And these longer fronds, which arch down and produce the spores on the end, they are the fertile ones, the ones that give the fern its very good appearance. And so on this division, we've actually got two small elkhorn ferns. Now we can either keep them as one, or we can make another division by simply cutting across here. Well, in this case, I'm going to leave it entire, but the question now is, what do I mount this particular elkhorn on? And the answer is a wide range of materials, actually. Hardwood is probably the best known. This is just a piece of local hardwood here, and it mounts onto there beautifully indeed. Or one of the favourites, which looks very nice in a garden situation, is something like a slab of tree fern trunk here. As long as you're not destroying tree ferns to get this, then it's very suitable. And note the hook in the top. It's got to be very securely attached because these ferns get to be very heavy and that is going to have to carry a great deal of weight. Okay, let's put it onto this one in this particular case. It will look beaut, I can assure you. And to do that, we simply place the fern in position the right way up, by the way. It's very important, on there. And then take a look at the way the fern is sitting. Let me show you that if you look at this plant sideways, you've got the two distinct leaves. These top leaves lean out and they catch debris falling from the tree or whatever, and that's what gives them their nutrition. If they don't lean out, then you need to pack the back with a bit of sphagnum moss, or a lot of sphagnum moss, or compost. It doesn't really matter, but it shouldn't be too rich. It should only be there to hold moisture rather than anything else. Now what we need to do is to hold that plant on the board long enough for it to form its own root system. A variety of ways of doing that. Wire is probably the most common, but don't use your normal garden wire. It won't last long enough. What you need to use is a longer lasting wire, like either a galvanized one, or what I'm going to use in this particular case, a piece of copper wire. The new base fronds will come out and cover the wire quite quickly. You need to thread it through. Here we go, it should be coming out somewhere on the other end. Right underneath on the back of the board. You might need an assistant to help you hold it in this particular case. Let's turn it over that way, put the wire on and tie it as tightly as you possibly can. And if necessary, twitch it with a pair of pliers too. Now, you might have to do that once or twice, but basically the fern is now roughly held in position. Note the nice sloping out part of the base leaves there, and this fern is going to be very happy indeed. There are other places you can put ferns like this. Back on the tree, for instance, where it came from, or onto another tree, but choose one that has a permanent bark. No good using a tree that has deciduous bark. The bark falls off, the fern falls with it. Here's one way of attaching it. Don't wrap a wire right around the trunk, incidentally. Put a couple of nails in the edge, a piece of copper wire, put your fern up there, and simply pull that wire around, over, and attach it back firmly to the other nail. There's an even simpler method, and it's awful. Use a galvanized nail with a big washer and simply hammer it into position.
This is a typical business, or is it? The office actually has got a garden in it, and that's something a little bit different, isn't it? It's because Fred Fennell is very interested in growing plants hydroponically, which simply means growing plants without any soil around them. It's a great way to go. Hello, Fred.
Hi, Jane.
Come over and tell us about what this is all about. It's a really fascinating way to grow plants.
It's a great way to grow plants.
Yeah. Of course, all plants, whether they be grown outside or inside, they do need basic things, though, don't they?
Yes, they need water, mineral salts, warmth and light.
Yeah, okay.
We provide these in hydroponics, and mineral salts, we have them in powder form, which we dissolve in water, and this makes our mineral water.
That's just the food for the plants.
That's the food for
the
plants.
Okay, that looks pretty easy. Now, to get them started, obviously they have to start in something, you know, how to get the seeds or the cuttings going.
Yes, we normally start them in the little grow wall propagating blocks, and we can put cuttings or seeds in those, and when the roots protrude from them, we can then go on to...
This looks exactly like the stuff, you know, that you put the rock wool, that you put the insulation in.
Very, very similar. It's called grow wool. It's specifically made for growing.
This looks a good one, though. I know that some people who can find that will find that a beaut way to grow.
Good old scoria, the cheapest and the best.
Good. And this one's light and fluffy?
That's right. That's a volcanic glass called perlite. And then we have our vermiculite, which is a mica-type material, also good for growing.
So all the plants can grow in any of those kind of situations?
Any of those things.
As long as they have light, if you're doing it in your office?
In our office, we've got to provide supplementary lighting with a grey light.
These
That's all they need.
Yeah. Now, there's another way that they can grow also. It's by growing them in troughs in water with the nutrient in it.
That's right, and we warm the water to about approximately 25 degrees Celsius with an aquarium heater, and then we have a little fountain pump just circulating the water around.
So the whole thing's just being recycled?
That's all there is to it.
It's easy, isn't it?
Simple.
Now, the troughs that they're growing in, though, that's just PVC, and anyone can get PVC.
PVC downpipe.
And how do you make the holes, Fred?
Just with a hole saw. Everybody's got a hole saw.
Well, I haven't, but I guess I could do it. Yes, that sounds pretty easy. Now, it amazes me the variety of plants you've got here. You start off with spinach, the old vegetable. That looks like ready to eat.
It is ready to eat.
Terrific.
You don't even need to cook it. Just eat it raw.
You move on.
Yep.
You've got
feverfew, parsley.
You've got the lovely odiclone mint.
Yes, good for tea. Lettuce, the red lettuce, green lettuce.
Those are
flowers.
Beautiful flowers. That's amazing. You can get flowers like that in the hydroponic system, isn't
it? You can get anything in a hydroponic system.
Well, take a look at this green lettuce. Now, look at that. That is astounding. How long has that been there like that for?
3 weeks.
God, that's fantastic growth, isn't it?
Yes.
Gee. Now, this is a really good system, Fred, but I know that there's a good way for amateurs to grow. What I've done here is take an indoor plant, washed it completely of all the soil around the roots, and I'm just going to put that into that pot there like that, and then with any inert material, but using clay pebbles like those, I'm just going to put that in to stabilise the plant into the pot, and then by feeding it with nutrient solution and a bit of water, mixed into the water actually, that plant will do very well. That's a very easy system.
That plant will grow equally as good as in any other system.
Yeah, it's good, isn't it?
Yep, very good.
And of course, if people want to learn more, they can go and join a hydroponic society. There's people like yourself who's, you know, really enthusiastic. You'll help them, won't you?
Of course we will.
Now, have a look at this, Fred. That's ready to harvest, eh?
Yes, Jane, one crop out and the next crop in. You can't get easier than that.
It's a great way to grow.
Someone's certainly been doing a lot of work here, and it looks good. This nice bark mulch around the garden and this lovely new path. It looks old, but it's new. But all of this has created a lot of stress on this tree. The building work that's been happening, the cutting through the roots to lay this path, and the removal of a tree that used to be here has caused this tree to have a problem. This chewed bark and webbing indicates that there's a borer in this tree, and borers usually only attack a tree when it's under stress. What you've got to do now is take a sharp knife and take all this away and see if you can find the entry hole of the borer. You might have a bit of a job to locate it, but when you do, just get some wire and poke it down the hole and kill the borer if it's still there. The important thing is that if you look after your trees, they're less likely to get borer.
You know, there are lots of plants in the garden that will make you sneeze and cause rashes to develop. But you don't have to be as dramatic as I've been and cut them out. Let's talk to one of the experts about allergies and rashes in the garden.
Well, the symptoms are mostly running and sneezing and itching, running of eyes, sometimes itching the roof of the mouth, and it generally comes on quite acutely at a particular time of year. But on the other hand, you can have an ongoing problem because up here in Queensland, for instance, there are grasses all the time and it can just be a continuing process. They often think they just keep on getting colds or they've always got a cold. They don't realise that it's an allergy.
Doctor, are garden plants the major culprits in this business of rashes and allergies?
Well, grasses really are the major culprit in breathing in allergies. Not so much in rashes, of course, but it's often particular plants in the garden that are the cause of the rashes.
This is a beautiful tree, particularly in the autumn when it gets those beautiful autumn tonings. But unfortunately, it's got a few problems, particularly if you're a gardener who's susceptible to the rash from the rust tree, because this is one of the rust family, and a lot of people can find they get quite serious rash from it. If you've got one and you don't want to get that rash, the only thing you can do is take off any of these low-hanging branches that are likely to rub against you. That way you eliminate the problem. Here's another one on the wanted list. This is a Diffenbachia. It's commonly called dumb cane, and the reason it's got that name is if you get some of the sap on your tongue, it'll all swell up and you'll never be able to speak for months. Maybe never again. Certainly not the thing for a Gardening Australia presenter. When somebody suspects they've got an allergy, what's the first step?
Well, if it's a particularly of a breathing in allergy, then there are various antihistamines that will help. And the first thing to do, I think, would be to go to the pharmacist. If what the pharmacist suggests isn't sufficient, then the next stop is your family doctor, because there are other things on prescription that are very effective. Rashes, of course, I think that's you really do need to go to a specialist for that.
Yet another plant on the wanted list, the philodendron. The philodendrons have a sap which can be extremely irritating for people with sensitive skins. So do watch out. If you're pruning a philodendron, watch out for that sap. It just about makes me cry to have to say this, but the sap of the mango tree can be quite irritating to some people with sensitive skins. So I guess if you've got a mango tree and you're one of those people, don't chop it out. Get someone in to help you pick the fruit and then send them all to me. Here's a plant that's common in a lot of Australia. It grows from the warm temperate areas right through the tropics. It's called Naked Lady simply because it doesn't have any leaves, but it's one of the real nasties in this whole business. The sap of this plant is terribly irritating, so watch out for it. It's a member of the euphorbia family, and a lot of the euphorbias have got this irritant sap. So keep your eye open if you've got a naked lady in your garden. If you find you've got a problem plant in the garden, Doctor, what are your alternatives? What's the gardener's alternatives?
Well, I think either to move it out of the way if it's overhanging a path, or even perhaps cutting it back. may help, but if you've got a contact allergy from a plant and you keep brushing against it, you're going to have constant trouble. So you've got to really, you know, really move it away from where there's going to be movement in the garden.
So you wouldn't advise then for gardeners to just to go around willy-nilly pulling out all their plants, ripping them out?
Oh, no, no, not at all. But on the other hand, that you know, some plants really just do have to be moved, and you have to accept that if you develop a contact allergy. If it's a breathing-in one, well, no, you don't have to rip them out. We don't want anybody to rip out their garden.
Well, as you can see, it pays to treat your plants with the greatest respect. Now listen, be honest, have you ever dreamed about having the most beautiful cottage garden? Well, you can. Sit back and be inspired.
This is a really fabulous old house. I really love it. And there's no doubt about it that old housing styles are really increasing in popularity. And the kind of garden that looks fabulous with them is the cottage garden. And they're also increasing in popularity. Look at this. Isn't it stunning? This is a really good example of a cottage garden, especially with these raised sandstone beds. And the plants work really well together. They're all mingled in amongst each other. And cottage gardens really are just made up of perennial plants that self-seed everywhere. So you don't have to keep putting in annuals that are going to have to die and be replaced every year. They're just wonderful. One of the beaut things about cottage gardens is you're always getting little surprises. Look at this lovely Erigeron daisy, which is self-sown among the rocks. And this Heartsy, or wild pansy, is just growing here by itself, and it's self-sown right through the garden. So if you like a really neat and tidy garden, which is well-ordered, cottage garden may not be for you. But one of the reasons that I love them so much is that you can have a few weeds, like these ones over here behind me, and it doesn't really matter because there's so much else happening in the garden. And if you want to stop your flowers from becoming a weed in the garden, like this lovely campanula here, all you need to do is deadhead them or take the flower heads off when they've finished flowering. There are literally hundreds of plants that you can choose from for a cottage garden, especially in a lovely sunny spot like this. And it's a good idea to get a variety of height and texture. One of the favourites for a cottage garden is the lavender. And there are many varieties. This is the French lavender, which is just lovely. And then, of course, there are the forget-me-nots. You can't forget them because they spring up all over your garden. And the Chinese forget-me-nots, which are a deeper blue, flower just about all year long. Another favourite of mine is the achillea, or yarrow. It comes in a variety of colours. This is a pink one, and it's a good cut flower. And a good solid plant in your cottage garden is the penstemon, or beard's tongue. And it has a lovely spike of flowers through summer. If you want a more delicate plant, there's these lovely Californian poppies. This one has a really soft, subtle yellow colour. And a cottage garden wouldn't be complete without the columbines. And they're also called granny's bonnets because they look a bit like a granny's bonnet. Now this particular columbine has self-sown in the full sun here and it's flowering beautifully, but they'll also grow in shade. There are a lot of cottage garden plants that will grow in the shade, and in this particular garden, shade's been created by these three trees, and under their canopy there are a vast array of plants growing. It's really lovely wandering along this path, and over here there's some Japanese anemone, which has died down now, but the flowers that come up later are really fabulous. But look over here, there's this wonderful winter rose. Very old-fashioned and has a real subtlety to its colour, but it's great in these shaded conditions. And here's one you might not know, it's the green goddess lily. See how this spathe around the flower is fringed with green, and it's a great cut flower. It lasts about 3 weeks in water, and it's a good idea to pick it because otherwise it will come up everywhere. I think cottage gardens are really special places, especially since you can share so many of the plants with your friends. And this particular garden has got an added bonus, and that is that it's attached to a nursery, which means that you can buy so many of the plants that you see here in the nursery and you'll know they're suitable. And I think that's a terrific idea.
If you need to tie a plant back, take a tip from nature. The passion vine, for instance, produces these lovely tendrils, and as the plants grow, these tendrils can expand. So you can make your ties do a similar thing, simply by wrapping your normal garden wire around a pencil to create a coil. And then, when you tie that coil onto the stake, secured around the plant, there's plenty of room in there for the plant to grow and expand in size without that tie cutting into the trunk.
One's a real problem because they dig up the blood and bone.
Oh, right. No, it might not a really big dog, it's only a young puppy.
Yeah.
But it just loves pot plants.
What about the...
I honestly believe that gardening is one of the most relaxing and satisfying of all hobbies, especially when it's shared with others.
I believe we've arrived, Pete. Is this the place
we're looking
for?
Yeah, this is it. I couldn't agree with you more. But isn't it marvellous these days how just about anyone, including people who are disabled, can still create and maintain their own gardens? Because no matter how difficult or awkward a job can be, there's always a simple, clever way of doing it. Actually, I sprayed my trees about 6 times, and every time I finish, it rained again and washed it all off. You know, I'm amazed at the remarkable range of ingeniously designed tools that are on the market. And they're there not just for people who are disabled, but they're so good that they're for everyone. Look at this, for example. It's nothing more than a lightweight handle, but into which is clipped a whole range of different heads. Look at this. Out goes a miniature rake, and in goes a small grass rake. Terrific. And here's another one. This is terrific. This is a stand-up seed sower. But remember that some of these can be quite expensive. Now, these look a bit rough and drab-looking, but honestly, they're mine. I've made these up, and in fact, they're capable of carrying out just about any job in the garden. But above all, they work. What do you reckon about that one?
I think it's great, Peter. I think it's great. One problem I do find with it, on reaching for something a little bit higher like that, the rope can't get away from you. Now, maybe if there was some sort of an eye there...
Or just down in the middle there. That's a terrific idea.
To hold the rope into there.
Otherwise, it's all right then, is it?
Otherwise, it's excellent. Well, I mean, if I was working like this at home with this garden in front of me and I had to prune something like that or cut away something like that, I'd have to go inside and get my wife to do it for me. With this, it allows me to be a completely independent gardener. And I can work in any garden with a tool like this, with this type of garden. Any person with a disability is able to do the gardening that they would like to do, not the gardening they can do.
You can't beat stainless steel when it comes to garden tools because it's so easy to clean. This is a cheap trowel, but I've bent the front up like that and form a cup. And the reason why, it's perfect for transplanting seedlings while still standing up. And there's some lovely cabbages just waiting to be moved. But the great advantage of this is a long handle. And it means that the job of transplanting can be carried out from a standing position. Now, Alan suffers from an acute form of arthritis. It prevents him from bending down properly. But I'd be interested, Alan, in how it goes, how you'd go here at transplanting these seedlings.
I'll give it a go.
What do you reckon?
It's quite easy.
You reckon you could put a small veggie garden in?
It's quite simple. Oh, I reckon if a bit of practice I could.
You must be wondering what this is. Well, you can see it's nothing more than a couple of garden stakes. I've driven a staple in here and it's attached to a cord so that when it's opened out like that, the string itself just flows through quite easily. That's attached to a reel, which unwinds. And what's actually going on, it enables you to put in garden stakes or pegs and a garden line quite easily without having to bend down. Trudy's doing it quite easily there. She can't bend down because she's suffering from arthritis. And all that's necessary at the end is to tighten the line by rotating the reel and securing it with an old bent nail. Now, Trudy, I've got a beauty for you here. It's my patent drill maker. All it is an old claw hole with two of the claws removed. Let me know how you think it works.
Thank you, Pete.
What do you reckon, Trudy? Pretty good?
Oh, yes, it is very good, very easy to handle. I don't have to bend down.
Well, that's what it's all about. You know, you don't have to bend down. It's as simple as that.
Yes.
The big question now is, how can you get the seeds down there? Look, it's dead easy. Hang on, hold those seeds a moment, Trudy. Get rid of him. Look, a very simple idea. It's nothing more than an ordinary funnel rammed into a piece of plastic conduit, and at the other end, it's been kind of shaped so it can more or less conform with the ground. And all that's necessary is that you put the seeds in one end and drag the conduit along the drill with the other, and the seeds come out marvellously, just like laying eggs. Beautifully so. Now, I'm going to do the really hard work now. Look, I've got a marvellous idea here. It's nothing more than a cheap nail rake that's been cut down to size to make it very small but very light, and it's mounted onto a piece of old doweling so that it can be operated quite comfortably with one hand while you're standing up. It's dead easy, and of course all you do is backfill perfectly. And there you are, a highly sophisticated backfiller. What do you think about that, Trudy?
It's very good, Pete. Looks very easy to do.
There's no end to the different types of tools you can design yourself for easy gardening. This is nothing more than a lightweight mattock on a long pole for one-handed operation. Terrific for getting rid of the big weeds. And here's another one. A trowel that with an extended handle. There it is. And it's also got another little handle along there to grip. Now, this is for people that have arthritis and can't bend their wrists. And by the way, you saw those plants that Alan put in. That's the first gardening he's ever done. And what are we trying to prove? Look, it's dead simple. No matter who you are, whether you're disabled or not, you can still take part in this wonderful hobby of gardening. It took me, less than half a day to make up those tools. So you can do it too. It's dead easy. And in fact, you'll probably come up with even better ideas to make gardening easy for everybody. Now, don't forget the Gardening Australia magazine for March. It's out now and it's absolutely terrific. It's crammed with information for you all about the garden. So don't miss out. Now, next week, we'll show you some magnificent new roses, and you'll see how to prune and care for them during autumn. It's so important. We'll meet one of the finalists in the Greening Australia Tree Care Awards. You'll be amazed and delighted by this novel approach to land care. And you'll see an outstanding collection of superb begonias and meet some expert growers. Learn the secrets of success. That's what I'd call green, practical and colourful. We'll see you next week.
Tomorrow, the ABC will telecast the first ordination of Australian women as priests of the Anglican Church from St George's Cathedral in Perth. Join us tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock in New South Wales, Victoria, Queensland and Western Australia, 11:30 in South Australia and the Northern Territory, and at 12 in Tasmania.